Hey guys, this is Michael Nasri. We're going to do a little walkthrough of D-Touch for Cubase running on a 46-inch touchscreen. The screen is a 46-inch Samsung HD screen with a PQ Labs G5S Touch overlay. It's running on a Windows 7 workstation, and I have Cubase 8 Pro loaded with a project open, and the D-Touch software is already running. So what we see here is the main D-Touch mixer screen. Over here we have the D-Touch toolbar, and it has a lot of its functions there. This is the macro panel where we can create macros, custom macros, and put them there, and I have a few there that you'll see. The macro engine is very powerful and deep, and I'm going to probably do a separate video to get a little more under the hood on macros. These are the multi-touch faders, of course. Over here is the channel editor, and to show and hide the channel editor, you touch the dB readout on a fader. Now, I always want that shown, but it is a floating window in Cubase, so it'll hide sometimes. So if it gets hidden, just touch the dB readout to show it again. Over here is the channel listing, and you can actually, in the D-Touch settings, there's an option to hide that if you want. So if you wanted to hide that, you'll get two extra faders on that side. And then on this side, you can optionally show the control room panel, which also has a tab for the large output meters. And if you choose to show that, then you'll lose two faders on this side. All right, so let's start by taking a look at the faders. The faders I find are very responsive to touch, and of course they are multi-touch faders, and they will track your fingers even if you move off of the fader cap. As long as your fingers are touching the screen, they'll be independently tracked. You also have multi-touch pans available, and there's solo and mute buttons, which are fully swipeable. Now there's three different types of faders available. There's this one called the high-res meter fader, and you can see that there's the high-resolution meter there with the solo and mute buttons, but you have indicators for other functions like reader, write, automation, state, record enable, input monitoring. If you want access to those functions, then there's a small meter fader, and this one replaces the high-res meter with the smaller meter. Still have the same long throw fader, but now we have buttons for all of the various functions like solo defeat, input monitoring, read and write automation, and fine fader mode down here. And fine fader mode puts the fader into fine mode where you can write really detailed small step automation. There's also a dedicated fine button there to turn all the faders into fine fader mode, or on or off. The third fader mode is called fade pad. It's very interesting. So what you get here is the high resolution meter and all of the buttons for all the functions, but instead of having a fader cap, there's a fader indicator here, which indicates the level of fader or where the fader cap would be. And then to adjust it, you touch the little fade pad here, and you can see the arrow moves up and down, and those are also multi-touch. So it's kind of a outside of the box take on the fader, and it's something that shows the power of working in software in the virtual environment. So I generally use the high-res meter because I do like to see the fader cap, and I like the high-res meter, but the other options are available for when we need to access the other settings. There are some other options available for the faders. If you watch it, if I touch anywhere in the fader track, it doesn't actually activate the fader. I have to touch on the fader cap, and that's how they work in normal mode. There's also jump mode, which will jump the fader cap under your finger whenever you touch inside of the track. There's also delta mode, which you just touch anywhere inside the track, and then the fader will maintain the delta distance between your finger and the fader cap. There's a zero set mode, which allows you to quickly set faders to zero. There's also minus infinity, so you can quickly pull your faders down that way. And by the way, zero set mode also works, and you can swipe along on the pans. All right, so the next thing I want to talk about is mixed navigation, and that's getting around your mix quickly and easily, and also showing the faders that you want at any given time right in front of you for control. So D-Touch has some buttons here, built-in controls, kind of the normal control surface controls, although we do have first bank and last bank. So last bank is going to move us all the way to the other end of the mix, and then first bank is going to bring us all the way to the left side of the mix. We have bank right and bank left buttons, which on my setup, because of what I've got shown and hidden, are going to move 20 faders at a time. And then channel right and channel left. So those are really useful. I use first bank and last bank a lot. But what I find even more useful is the channel overview bar at the top here. And it's not just a meter bridge. It's actually a scroll bar. So you can use it to scroll up and down the mix, and you know, because it's a really good size, it's much bigger than my finger, there's never any mistouches or anything like that, unlike using the narrow scroll bar at the bottom. So I use that a lot, probably my most used function to move up and down the mixer. Now in conjunction with that, I use the visibility configurations a lot, and you can see on my macro panel I have some macros set up that have to do with showing and hiding channels and creating new configurations, things like that. And these are really simple macros. They're just sending key commands, and I've set those key commands up in Cubase to do things like show all channels, show just your selected channels, hide selected channels. So how I use them is let's say we've got this track selected. There's a button here for control. Now you see that's flashing. That's actually the control key, and that's the same exact thing. It's latched, and it's same as me holding down the control key on my keyboard. So with that flashing, I can now select other channels, and then you know we could zoom down the mix a little bit, and let's say you know you wanted to throw some vocals in there too. Now I can just say show selected channels, and boom, the channels that I selected are in front of me instantly. And at any time, it's really easy to just jump up and down your mix. I'm going to do it one more time. Show all channels. Now I'm back to all my channels being displayed. This time, I'm going to start with my room kit, control. I'm going to grab those. And then we're going to slide up the mix a little bit. And yeah, I want to grab those. Then show selected channels. And there they are. So really quick and easy to instantly grab the faders that you want and put them in front of you. You don't need to have it like planned out from the beginning. You can at any time in the mix just jump up and down and grab the faders you want, put them right in front of you. Now if you do want to come back to this particular configuration over and over again, you can create a new configuration. I have a button labeled create visibility, but that's just what I named it, and I'm going to name this one R2. And so now that's saved in this menu here, and I have some others, like here's a vocals one called that Vox. And now if I just want to go back to the one I just created, there it is. So it's very powerful, very easy to move around your mix however you want, grab channels instantly, put them right in front of you, save certain groups to go back to as many times as you want. Okay, so let's take a look at the channel editor. The channel editor lets us get access to the selected channels plugin inserts, our sends, and also the channel EQ and channel strip. You also have your input and output settings, so you can change those. I found that the EQ responds very well to touch, tracks really nicely, and on the big touch screen, it's got a nice large surface to work with. You see, I have FabFilter Pro Q2 loaded here. It's one of my favorite plugins, especially using with a touchscreen, and it's obviously a much bigger EQ surface to work with. I also like the way FabFilter has their knob set up. So if you touch in the big portion of the knob, it's a linear control. If you touch in the white portion, it's a circular control. So FabFilter Pro Q2 is used a lot in my sessions. If you want to add a new plugin, just tap it on the box, and then you can scroll the list up and down. So let's say we want to add Oxford Inflator. And I have Cubase set to not open the window automatically when I insert a plugin. So you just tap once to open it. And even a plugin like the Inflator, which is actually has a relatively small user interface, especially compared to newer plugins, it's very large on the big touch screen, and you can see that the control faders are still larger than my finger, very easy to touch. You see, I close my plugins using the escape key on my keyboard. There's also a button on the D-Touch control panel to close all, so that'll close multiple plugin windows, however many you have open. Now, one thing about Cubase is that it uses hover buttons to do things like bypass and unbypass a plugin or insert, and also if I wanted to remove that plugin or change it to a different one, you need to move the mouse into there. But what I found is that if you tap it with two fingers, that Windows will actually move the mouse pointer there and light up the bypass the light up the hover buttons, but it doesn't send the click through. So now I can just tap the little down arrow, and I can choose a different plugin if I want. Let's say Asana EQ. And I haven't really found any plugins that aren't very easy to work with on the big touch screen. Even ones that have very crowded interfaces like Eventide, Ultra Channel, or something like that. On the send side, it's very easy to control send level, of course. To insert a new send, you would just tap and then tap the down arrow, and I only have a few FX buses available. The sends are inserted bypass, so you tap and then bypass and unbypass. That's the same way you could bypass and unbypass a plugin, but there's actually a much better way. D-Touch has a bypass mode, so you touch that button there, and while that's lit, all you have to do is touch a slot, and it will bypass or unbypass, and you can actually swipe to bypass and unbypass. So, a really quick and easy way to bypass and unbypass plugins and sends. Now, if you want to get an overview of all the plugins and sends that you have loaded, you can hit the Show Racks button up here, and that hides the D-Touch toolbar and channel editor, and now you have the Cubase Racks shown. I have mine set up so that I only have the inserts and sends shown, but there's options to show a lot of different options in the racks, and of course, if you touch there, they'll collapse them. So if you have multiple things shown in your racks, you can touch and to expand and collapse. Then you can use the channel overview bar to scroll up and down your mix, so you can quickly get an overview of where you have certain plugins inserted or where you have sends. So speaking of sends, and I'll just show you the channel editor is closed now. So we touch the dB value, it opens up again. So as you see, like showing and hiding certain things hid the channel editor, but it's very easy to get back open. So speaking of sends, there's actually a even better way to work with sends, and this is something that I asked the D-Touch team about because I was used to working with flipping the sends down to faders of my tracks on my hardware control surface. So they were able to implement the same thing in the new sends mode, and this is something that I'm beta testing right now. It's a new feature. So hit that button that puts it into sends mode, and you can see that the faders all kind of changed because instead of being volume faders, now they're send level faders for each track that's displayed. And then we have eight buttons here, numbered or labeled 1 through 8. Those correspond to the eight send slots that we have here. So if I go to send slot one and I adjust the fader for the track that's shown in the channel editor, you can see that I'm adjusting send for level or the level for send one, for send two, send three, and of course you got multi-touch control here, so you can control a whole bunch of tracks at one time, and it's a great way to work with if you set up your tracks that are going into the same FX buses, put that the send on the same slots in on your tracks. Then when you bring them together, you bring the faders together, you're able to have multi-touch control over the send levels into those buses. Really great way to work with sends. But there's even more. So I'm going to turn off sends mode here. The D-Touch team took that sends idea and they took it to another level even. And they came back, and this is another feature that I'm beta testing right now. This is called the Matrix window. So this really blew my mind when I saw it. This is a basically a whole little mixing environment all in itself. And what it is, it's a grid of 128 tracks. Every one of those blocks is a track. You've got the track name. There's meters. And right now, this button up here is volume button, so we're in volume mode, so we can adjust the volume level of the tracks, and of course it's multi-touch. So you can do actual mixing right in here, 128 tracks at a time. So this is tracks 1 through 128, then you can get 129 through 256. We've got input buses, output buses, and any VCA faders you have. I don't have any in this session. Now there's also fine fader mode, so that lets you do the more fine control over your volume. Then there's send mode, and there's 8 send buttons here, so that's giving you access to those 8 send slots for every track that you have in your project. And so we can multi-touch control send over slot 1 or slot 2, etc., up to slot 8. There's also bypass mode here, so you can actually bypass and unbypass your sends right from here. Now, like I said, this is the matrix window is a feature that I'm beta testing, and my mind started racing when I first saw it, and I sent the D-Touch team some suggestions and requests for additions to the matrix window, and they're actually looking at doing them. And so some of them that I'd love to see would be a pan mode, maybe a pan button there so we could adjust pans along with volumes. I'd also like to see mute and solo buttons with indication, maybe some colored indication on the matrix blocks that would show muted and soloed tracks. And I'd like to see a select button to be able to select tracks or multiple tracks. And that way you could be mixing in the matrix, and then if you wanted to get to the plugins for certain tracks, you could select those tracks, close the matrix, hit your show selected channels, and right there you'd have your faders and your channel editor for the tracks that you wanted to work with plugins. But as it is right now, the matrix is a very powerful tool for adjusting your track volumes, levels, and your send levels. And it's very possibly going to evolve into an even more powerful tool. And basically, like I said, a whole little mixing environment where you get a bird's eye view and can do a complete mix right from this one screen. So I'm going to close that. One other thing I wanted to show you earlier, I use the control key to select multiple channels, so let's do that again. And when you have multiple channels selected, there's the quick link button on the D-Touch toolbar. It's the same as hitting the quick link button up there. And then when you have quick link activated, now you've got a temporary grouping of whatever you have selected, whatever tracks you have selected. And you can do that for volume, for your volumes, mutes, things like that, but also for inserting plugins and sends. And that's how I like to insert plugins across multiple tracks at once, or assign sends across multiple tracks at once. And also, besides quick link, we also have a link unlink button, and that brings up the new link group settings window. And here you can define, if you want to create a new link group, you can define what you want linked, and you can also create a VCA fader right from there. Okay, so that's going to cover the walkthrough for the mixer side of the D-Touch screen. So we're going to go over to the project side. We hit the swap windows button, and now we're in the project side. Now I have to tell you that I have not spent a lot of time working in the project side in D-Touch or with the touch screen yet, I should say. I've spent just about all my time bringing in edited projects and working in the mixing side. So I still have to learn more about the tools and the available functions on the project side. And I'll probably do a follow-up video when I have a little more information available. But I can go through some of the basic functions and the functions that I do use when I jump over here. First of all, it's really easy to move the cursor around. And if you move up and down, you're going to scroll horizontally. So the only problem with that is that the cursor moves away from your finger, which is I find to be kind of a pain. I have macro keys. They're just sending keyboard shortcuts to set the left and right locators. So that's something I'll come out and do sometimes, is just set the locators real quick. There's a lot of functions available on the toolbar here. Over here we've got the various mouse modes, like your pointer, your pencil, things like that. Buttons to open up the quantize panel, cut, copy, and paste, and your arrow keys, shift, alt, control, delete, some snap functions, nudge functions. And of course right here we have the nav pad, and I like to float the nav pad. And this lets us zoom our tracks. You can zoom horizontally, vertically. You can scroll. I guess if we scroll out and can show it easier to scroll, we can scroll up and down. Now, one of my favorite things to do in... let me get that a little bigger. One of my favorite things to do in the project side is to draw automation. So if I grab the pencil tool, and like this already has some automation written, but we're going to, you know, let's say I wanted to go up and down, just saw draw some crazy automation. But as you can see, it tracks the finger really well. Let me zoom that in a little bit. And so if I wanted to bring that forward and go down here and come up here, and I'm going to do a little fade out. Drawing automation works really well, and of course there's, you know, a lot of different automation types available that we can change to. Also, grab the pointer, and I'm going to open the MIDI editor, and we're going to move it into where our data is. And the same as drawing automation, we can easily draw CC data. It works really well. If you grab the pencil, for example, I have velocity here, and you can see that it's very easy and accurate to draw CC data. Here's some CC11. So, you know, if you've got, say, LA scoring strings and you want to create some movement dynamics, you'd you do your CC11, you can do your CC2. But that works really well. Back to the velocity, I found if you select some tracks, or select some notes in the MIDI editor, and you tap in the little box that gets highlighted, now you can scale your velocity information up and down for the selected track, so that works really well. Now, the MIDI editor window, when I first, you can see that it's sitting right above the D-Touch toolbar. The first time I opened it, it was actually going down to the bottom of the screen, so I had to resize it, and once I resized it once, Cubase remembers the size and location. I know that the D-Touch team is looking at maybe a dedicated MIDI editing mode, which would auto-size the MIDI editor and give us some additional tools on the toolbar for editing MIDI notes and things like that. Also, they've been talking about adding some things to the nav pad, maybe some, you know, note editing or nudge trim, things like that. So if you have anything specific you'd like to see, it's definitely worth reaching out to emailing D-Touch about it or talking to them on the forums. They're very open to suggestions. And I've found that basically if you have something you'd like to see in D-Touch and it's technically possible, they'll probably implement it for you. So that's going to do it for my overview of D-Touch. If you have anything specific that you'd like to see in a future video, please let me know. Like I said, I'm planning to do a video on macros to get a little under the hood on macros, and I'm going to revisit the project window when I get a little more comfortable in working with it and with the touchscreen. And there'll probably be some macros that we'll write that will do some repetitive tasks and take care of some things as far as editing is concerned. All right, thanks a lot for watching.